New England Candle Pins is made possible through the generous support of the U.S. Candlepin Bowling Association. Learn more at uscandlepin.com. By Ryan Family Amusements in Millis, Massachusetts. Visit ryanfamily.com. By your community's public access channel. And by your Franklin friends and neighbors, good folks just like you. Thanks for supporting Franklin TV. And thanks for watching.
From Ryan's Family Amusement in Millis, Massachusetts, it's New England Candlepins. And our first Elite Eight show, Wally the Gator Flannery takes on Jeremy House Rules Seaholm. Then in game two, Jason Double Guns Doucette takes aim at Brian the Hammer Fournier. Now let's roll with your host, Jay Horrigan.
Welcome to our first match of our Elite Eight shows. We are with our first two bowlers, Wally Flannery and Jeremy Seaholm. First of all, Jeremy, welcome back to an Elite Eight. You get to take on Wally Flannery. Have you bowled against Wally before?
I haven't bowled against him, but I've bowled with him.
Okay. It seems like we just talked just a few short minutes ago. It's been a while. Have you been bowling recently?
This string, I'm just trying to hit 100.
You know what? That's a goal, and we all need to have goals, and that's an awesome one to have.
I'm a goal-oriented kind of guy.
Well, that's good. Wally, you come in here after bowling a tremendous 106 that brought you to our Elite Eight. If you bowl 106 compared to what Jeremy bowled in the original show, you'd come out on top.
Well, hopefully that's what I want to do.
Well, that's good. That's good. Have you been bowling?
I've been doing consistent. Not good, not bad, consistent.
Well, that's good. That's good. Well, we're looking forward to these two powerhouses squaring off in today's match. It should be a barn burner. We're looking for high scoring. Pins flying left and right, taking circuitous routes to just get all around the alleys. So, enough of that. We're ready. Matt, let them roll. Welcome back to Ryan's Family Amusement, and we're ready to bowl in our first match. Up first is Jeremy Seaholm. We're joined, as always, by Dave Chestercove. Dave, welcome.
Thank you.
Who's beside you?
Richie Myrick.
Where? Oh, here I am.
Oh. Oh, Jeremy tries to convert the half Worcester. Leaves a mess for his third ball. Not entirely his fault. Leaves the 4, 5, 7, 10. No wood. And makes it a 7 bucks. This is our first match of our Elite Eight bracket. Jeremy leaves the three horsemen. This particular three horsemen is the 1-3-6.
There are a lot of different variations
indeed
of the three horsemen.
Oh, takes the hit pin outside. Gets everything but the three pin.
Yeah, it took the one off the wall into the six, but it didn't hop forward for that three pin. Jeremy defeated Dan Schwinard to get here.
And just a 9 box for Jeremy.
Here in our quarterfinal series, if I may. Jay?
Yes. Next up is Wally the Gator Flannery.
Wally leaves my favorite leave, this time the right side version, the 1-3-4-6-7-9. Tries to go outside, but finds the hole. Oh, just a head pin on that ball.
Well, Wally will be getting a phone call about the $5.
Why?
It's an inside joke, DC. There's like four people at home that'll get that one.
Oh, all right. Just
and
four?
I mean, that's four out of the six that usually tune in, so.
Well, it was a great ball, though. Drops nine.
Yep,
he's got
the kick
pin. That was pretty scary, Richard.
Just a hair to the left on that one.
And he gets a 10 bucks. So, despite the $5, Wally only finds himself down one. I'd say that's a pretty good recovery. So, Jeremy leaves the Kaliri left. That's the 1-2-4-7-9. There's a piece of wood by the 9 pin.
That's kind of creeping up a little bit. That's not making it any easier. Still just trying to make the four horseman here.
Yep.
Takes the one and the nine out. As always, pin to win here. Can't get any marks in the early going. The third ball is the most important. That's a nice
and he
10.
Converts it for a 10, yep.
Jeremy at 26 through three frames.
Jeremy on the head pin, drops six, leaves the 2-4-6-10. Oh, we've seen a lot of splits in this season so far. Jeremy trying to convert, gets the two on the left. Looking for $10.
Yeah, we have seen a lot of splits, DC, and we've seen a lot of some lower scores, especially for a house like Ryan Family Amusements, which tends to be a fairly quicker house, I think, in my opinion, anyway. If you like,
my assessment would be the same.
Let's see if our bowlers can get it going here. Flannery, just 15 after two, but. Jeremy with just 36 through 4, so the door's open.
Wally, good ball, drops 7. Leaves the triangle right, the 3-5-6. Oh, takes out just a 5.
Dave, Wally is bowling right now on lane 2 under the USCBA sign. Tell us a little bit about the USCBA.
Sure. The USCBA is a membership organization. We are dedicated to help promoting the game in every aspect that we can. And in this case, with New England Candlepins, we do support the show, and that is why our banner is there. If you're interested in learning more, you can find us on our website, www.uscandlepin.com. So Wally, off to the left, gets 7 down. He leaves the 1-8-9. Kind of a unusual.
That's a different one. You usually take out the 1-8-9. You usually don't leave it. I mean, essentially, he took out the spread eagle plus the 5 pin.
Really
thought he had it too. Wow. Head pin just jumped right over the 8 there. Again, all important pins. This pin here would keep it within 1 through 4.
Very good job for Wally.
You know, it's almost like stroke play in golf, DC.
Yep, that's exactly what we're seeing right now.
Except you get 10 holes instead of, 9 or 18.
That is true.
And there are no clubs.
And it doesn't take 4 hours to play.
Well, the way you would have it, Jay, is you would have them beating each other with clubs in between boxes. You would have
would make it interesting.
Bowling. Yeah.
Well, I agree.
Jeremy, not able to convert his single pin for a spare. Seen a lot of labored balls so far. I don't know whether it's the nerves of the spotlight or just mechanic issues. Jeremy rolling a great first ball.
That's a good first ball. Weird leave though. He's got the 2, 7, and 8 with a piece of wood that's lined up directly straight back, lined up on that 2-pin. He's pretty much going to have to drive it back, I think.
Yeah, he's going to have to kiss it. Yeah, he kissed it like he was supposed to. He doesn't get a break to carry the 7.
Wood came back and kissed the 7, too. He even gave it a wiggle.
But he does convert for the 10 bucks, so he's not leaving anything up there.
All important 10 boxes. That gives him, through completed boxes, 21 pins ahead. That forces Wally into a mark in this situation, you know?
Yeah.
As opposed to getting the 9, he gets 2 tens and he's tied. It's a lot different in a one-string match when you absolutely know you need a mark to catch up. What a break.
Big break for Wally. Misses the headpin, but he's able to get some action off the wall and just leaves the 4-7. He has some wood out there. Not sure exactly how much it's going to help from back here. I don't have the proper angle. Can he drive it straight back? He does.
Right back. That's a good shot. Good smart shot, too. I'm not sure if he went to the right.
That's exactly what I was thinking. I wasn't quite sure how much room he had over there because I sit way off to the right here. But Dan did the right thing, makes the spare.
See, he could have capped it off the wall, too. There was a lot of ways to miss that shot. He played it just right.
Yeah, yeah.
So Wally working off a spare in the 5th.
Timely ball. Timely ball, and that's 9.
That is 9. Leaves just the 2-pin. Piece of wood to the right of the 2-pin. Maybe an issue if he's a little off to the right, but it could also help him. Not quite sure how it'll react.
Oh.
But he's off to the left, so not able to convert that for a spare. And just a 9 box for Wally. But he grabs the lead away from Jeremy and has a 7-pin lead. With 4 boxes to go.
Single digits heading into the home stretch.
Jeremy with a good looking ball. Finally carries the extra pin.
Big ball from Seaholm there.
Drops 8, leaves the 2-4.
2-4, I hate to say it, DC, but what do you think about that wood on the right?
I think it's too deep, but I know I would just go right at the 2-pin. Oh, he decided to play it.
All right, let me try this again. I hate to say it, DC, but what do you think about that one on the right?
I still wouldn't have played it, but Jeremy thought it was still good. apparently it was just high enough for Jeremy, so good for Jeremy.
Jeremy picks up the spare in the conventional way.
Jeremy rolls up another good ball on it, drops 7.
Well, let's see what this wood's going to do.
Is he going to take out the 7-pin? It will stay on the lane, so he could hit it and try to get those pieces of wood moving out of the gutter, or play the 5-pin, or play the curtain.
Well, I think he may have actually been trying the 5-pin there. I'm not sure.
It
that
looks like he was trying to cut
the
5
pieces in the gutter.
Yeah, it's a tough shot no matter what.
We'll see. We'll see if he tries it here. He's gonna go for it. That didn't do much.
Yeah, it was a tough shot no matter what. You really didn't have many options. But he gets 8. Does get a spare. Jeremy, through completed frames, has 81 through 8. Wally has 63 through 6. Wally with a good-looking ball. Oh, no, only...
Excellent ball. 5-7.
Leaves a 5-7. Piece of wood.
Yeah, wood just
between
behind the five.
Yep, just behind the five.
It's not frozen on, though.
Question is it too deep or not?
We still may be able to find out.
Take two. See what...
Big pins here, though.
Oh, absolutely.
It's one the hard way, I suppose.
Yeah. He was going for the 5-pin, but he kept that wood, and the ball took out the 7-pin.
What's up at 72, Jeremy at 81. Wally, though, with this box in hand, he can throw a mark here. Put himself in really fine position going into the final two frames.
Wally with a great ball right in the 1-3 pocket. Drops 8 in a hurry.
Probably the best ball he's thrown all match.
Leaves the 5-8 piece of wood to the left. Looks like it has a decent angle, but I'm curious to see what Wally will do. If he'll play the wood or try to play the pin. Plays the wood and he converts.
Good call, DC. Push the wood right back into that 5-8. No question about it. Spun it right in, and that puts the pressure squarely back on Seaholm.
Absolutely.
Chasing one pin, plus that mark.
Jeremy's going to want to mark here. Jeremy with a great ball. Drops 8 in a hurry, but not a very good 8, unfortunately. Tough break leaves the 7-10 split.
Yeah, it looked like a good splashdown ball at first, but boy, this is...
He does have a piece of wood by the 3-pin. Like. If he hits a corner of the cap, I would guess the right side, he might get it. Well, he's... See if he tries again. Ooh, he wanted it, but not able to convert, just an 8.
Yeah, that was tight quarters there.
Oh, extremely.
Thought he was going to get one anyway. Now, essentially a must-mark situation for Jeremy Seaholm.
Oh, you wanted that 5 to go, and thank goodness it went. Made the attempt for the spare a lot easier. Leaves the triangle left. The 4-7-10. No.
Wow.
Punches the 4-pin straight back. And he gets a 9 bucks. So Wally firmly has the match in his control.
Yep,
all he has to do is, I think maybe roll one good ball here for his fill and certainly make things easy for him. Wally with a strike.
Oh, wow.
And that'll seal the deal right there. Well, not technically. He still has to fill his strike. He has 92 through completed frames, but he is on a strike versus Jeremy's 98.
Follows up the best ball he threw all match with an even better one.
So he needs at least a 4 fill and a strike, and the match will be over. Anything less, and he's still fighting for his life. But that wasn't going to happen. Drops 8 right away. Makes it, seals the deal for him. He's going to move on to our final 4.
Yep.
Can he convert?
Ooh, oh! Almost got it.
And a 10 box for a very good scorer from Wally. A 121 to Jeremy's 98. Jay, take it away.
So 121, our high score so far.
Well, as far as we know, in the Elite Eight anyway.
As far as we know.
So far.
Well, we haven't seen all the other episodes yet, Jay.
That's thus so far. thus so far. It's going to be a long, strange trip that we've only just begun. So we'll be back to talk to our bowlers and not Richie in just a moment. We're back here with our bowlers from our first Elite Eight match. First of all, Jeremy. Excellent. Wally bowled great.
He did. He made some nice key shots at the end. I did not.
He especially the second half of the match, he was really, his ball was right on the head pin. The pins really started falling. You had some nice shots, but the pins didn't fall for you.
I had a little bad luck, but, you know, didn't help myself the first half.
Yeah, yeah. Well, hey, for advancing this far, $125, the bad news is now you've got to go back to work.
I'm not working today.
Well, that's good. Day off. Excellent. Excellent. Well, hey, we appreciate, again, you being hosting New England Candlepins here at Ryan's Family Amusement. It's a great place. You do a great job. We love coming here. So
glad to have you guys.
Well, thank you very much. Wally, congratulations.
Thank you.
Great match. Great second half of the match.
The ball felt really good going in.
Yeah, you were bowling really well. You were on the head pin, and then the pins in the second half really started to fall for you.
Yes, they did. When I missed the nine pin drop, I thought I was done. Jeremy's a great opponent, but I came back and I just kept on hitting the head pin. So,
well, excellent. You advanced to the final four. So later on, we'll see who you take on, and you get a chance there to advance to the finals.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, great job for a first timer on the show. Yes. So. We'll be back momentarily with our next match in this Elite Eight show.
What is community without community support? Without community access? Without communication that creates a common bond. You can make community by making community TV. Contact your public access community TV center. Learn how you can help, because you can. Volunteer today. When you support your community TV, you also support your community.
Welcome back to our second match of today's show. We're with our bowlers. First, Jason Doucette. Jason, Elite Eight.
Yep, Elite Eight.
Elite Eight. I don't think we really need to say much more than that.
Nope. Yep. Nope. Go to Brian.
Okay, we're going to Brian now. Brian, we've pretty much said it all. Have you ever bowled against Jason?
Couple times in tournaments, but nothing really head-to-head wise. So first time facing him, so it should be fun.
All right. Well, Jason and I just pretty much set it all Elite Eight.
I agree. You know, just hope I can throw a better ball than last time, throw a little bit better of a score.
Excellent. Excellent. Not much more to be said about that. The only thing left to be said is roll 'em. Welcome back to New England Candlepins as we're ready to start this next Elite Eight match. Yeah, he said. First up is Jason Doucette. No idea.
Jason Doucette got here by beating Aaron Albadell, 119 to 111.
Yeah, that was a pretty good match.
It certainly was.
Aaron held together really well.
Very impressed.
Yeah, nice first appearance on the program for the young man.
Jason,
four horsemen.
Jason takes a little time to get on the board. Runs down the four horsemen left.
Yeah,
only three. Takes out the 3-9-6. Oh, goes outside the head pin, or the right side of it. Try to take the spare. Gets a majority of them. Leaves three pins left. And still leaves three for a 7-box. So just 20 for two. Excuse me, 19.
No, that is 20. That's correct.
Yeah, I don't know why it says 19 up there, but it is 20.
Yeah, just the camera down by the lanes with the auto scoring here sometimes doesn't pick up the pin, but we've got it. We've got it all set back here, so Jason is at 20 for two.
He's got
Brian Fournier up now.
Brian rolled a great ball against Nick Norcross in the quarterfinals. Didn't get much to show for it, but he did pull away. I believe the score was 110 to 102. So Brian looking to clean this up for 9 or 10 bucks, and he does that. It's a 9.
Excellent third ball, continuing where he left off in the match against Norcross. I think that's what really was the key to that match.
Absolutely.
Seemed to be right in there, most importantly. I mean, it's the only ball you got left if you've left two standing.
Oh, looking for the strike, and he gets it.
There. What a ball.
Leaves the triangle right, the 3-5-6. Looking to convert, and he does.
Nice. All over.
Makes it look easy.
It's a good way to answer a strike, make a difficult shot like the triangle.
What a great ball there out of Jason. Ran the 1-3 pocket flush. Drops 9, leaves just the 7 pin.
Right,
and he
face.
Converts.
Right in the face.
So, Jason answers with 2 marks right back at Brian. Brian up on lane 2, working on a strike of his own. For the double, trying to carry the 10. Well, he drops 7 on the first ball, leaves a split. The 4-7-10. Piece of wood behind the 4 and the 7, and one out in front of the 10 pin. Probably play the 4-7, at least try to get your 9 fill in the strike. See if you can get lucky and carry the 10. Ooh, he goes right down the middle.
Yeah, I think with this one, DC, you almost want it almost on the 7 pin.
Yep. Yeah, if you're looking to definitely convert the shot, I think you got to be down low. But, he gets a 9 box. Yeah,
interesting 9.
Takes out the 7-10, but leaves the 4.
So even when he misses on the third ball, he's been.
Yeah, I guess so.
That's pretty cool. Now opposite the spare and chasing just 3 pins, though.
Yep. Drop 6. He's the 1-4-7-10. 2 pieces of wood down by the 4-7 pin. Brian's second ball this match so far is a little shaky, it looks like, but his third ball is dead on.
Let's see if we can keep the form on the third ball here.
Absolutely.
These are important pins.
He always seems to make the right adjustment on the third ball. And he did the right thing. He took his minutes and went after the easy 2, carried 3, got a good 9.
Yeah, if you go for the head pin there, sometimes you end up beating a 6 box instead of guaranteeing yourself a little bit of extra count.
Yep.
Now back on lane 1, here's Jason Doucette on the fill.
Especially, I always say in a single string match, you you have to take your medicine, I think, a little more often than not. In a three-string match, maybe you go for the head pin this early in the match and see what happens. Try to get your rhythm, too. But in a single-string match, I always say, go, just take your medicine, get your pins, get your count, keep yourself in the match. But Jason's not going to make it easy for him. He drops nine and gets another spare.
No, count's going to have nothing to do with it if Doucette keeps Pepper in this pocket like he is right now. He's got that ball working really well. Look at that.
Oh, it drops another nine.
Boy, when you're going good, you're going good. That ball could be two and two sometimes. That ball is just instead, it's a dunk nine drop. Red line and nothing more. Spins it right in
right
there.
Into it. We were just talking before he rolled, Richie, about how zoned in Jason looked.
Oh, he really did. He seemed like it. I like to try to have a little bit of fun with the bowlers before they get up there. Try to break them off camera a little
Jason
bit.
Jason was having none of it.
No, he was not having my act.
What a good ball from Brian. Drops nine of his own.
Got the clean six pin.
It's pretty much, you really hate to say in the fifth box it's a must make, but by the way Jason's bowling, it is a must make one. And he does.
Never a doubt on it as well.
So Brian working off a spare in the fifth.
Looking for some help.
Almost had it at that eighth fell. It could have been interesting. He may have stolen a couple of pins, but it'll be just four on the fill. The 1, 3, 5, 8, 9, and 10. Will it?
Oh,
will it not? Just the 1-3?
Wow.
Where did everything go?
How did that happen?
Oh, yeah.
Looking to clean this up, and he almost makes the 10 box.
Now Jason Doucette working on a spare.
Working on a few spares here. See if he can keep the streak of nine drops going.
Ooh, just three.
Yeah, just three. Chops out to the left a little. Four horsemen right, four pin, five pin, seven pin. Favorable wood behind the head pin.
Almost gets it to clear. Will the three fall into it? Oh, will it go? It goes anyway. Well done. Great shot.
Jason's fifth mark.
He'll certainly take it.
Absolutely. I wasn't quite sure that pin was gonna fall, and it fell the right way. Oh, and he drops nine again.
That's the quickest nine we've seen.
Just a 10 pin, nothing in the way. And makes it look easy, folks.
Right in the
Jason
jaw.
Is on fire right now.
Puts him at 118.
118 plus a ball in two boxes. Really not making it easy for Brian. Brian is almost in a double strike situation right now. Being down 23 for completed frames for Brian. And he drops nine. Maybe. Well, go make it.
Nice,
and he does.
Nice.
Brian's been bowling really well. It's just, spare after spare from Doucette. Really pushing to the limit. See if he can continue to answer the call. On the spare. Spins it up a little bit.
Yeah. Gets five. Leaves the 1, 2, 4, 8, 10 pin. Piece of wood by the 10 pin should help. But he's got to hit the head pin. Just off to the right. And a 7 box for Brian.
Jason working on a spare again.
Indeed, 118 plus a ball. Gets six, leaves the four horsemen left. Well, he made this to open.
Yep, decent mix. Wouldn't be surprised if he does it again.
Oh. And an $8.
$8 puts him at 132. So we need a large mark for 150 string, but
150 will officially close out, mathematically close out Brian. Brian's max score is 149 if he strikes out. And Jason throws a strike. Breaks up the spread eagle. And Jason with a very impressive score of 151. Almost got to the high single for the show.
He got pretty close.
Which we think. What do you think, a... Looking back,
if memory serves me correctly, it's Skip Easterbrook with 153, but I could be mistaken.
I thought we had a 156, maybe, by one of the Legendras.
I know Mike Legendra put up a good number, but I can't remember what it was.
But it's at mid-150s.
It's definitely in the 150s, I know that.
Yeah.
Well, Brian, with a spare of his own. Ran into a buzzsaw this match. Not much you can do but tip your cap and just pull your game. Looking for a strike.
That's going to fall.
Well, he gets eight.
Yeah, Brian certainly went down swinging in this
absolutely.
One. No question
absolutely.
About it.
Brian's score will come up short in this match, but it wins just about any other match.
Well, so far in the majority of our matches, yeah, 116
right.
would definitely
with that so far.
At least ask a question or two.
He ran in, as you said, a buzzsaw. Just Jason was all the nines. Jason put
nobody
up,
was stopping but, Jason this
yeah,
match.
Unbelievable.
So well done to Jason Doucet.
Yeah. So we will be back to talk to both bowlers in just a moment. We're back here with our bowlers after just a tremendous, tremendous match. First of all, Brian, 116, pretty much wins any match we've had so far in this series. Except you ran into an unbelievable Jason Doucet.
He was on all the whole string. It was great bowling. You can't be ashamed to lose to that because, I didn't have enough to up my game. I fell behind too fast, and he just kept bringing it. Didn't matter. So it was a hell of a string from him. So.
Well, and we were just talking before we came back on the air that we think his 150 may be the third or fourth highest score in the history of New England candlepins. So there's not much you can do when you run into that.
No, not at all. I mean, it was a lot of work to just, even keep up that. It's still rough, but he just, everything was great for him. The ball was breaking everything up, and hell, I think he should have had a few more strikes in there. A lot of nine drops that I thought were more hammers than not,
right.
But
right. Hey, you had a tremendous showing for your first time on our show too, so you should take a lot of comfort in that.
I do. I appreciate the chance to bowl, and I did all right. I felt like I could have done a little bit better, but I'll take it. you learn, live and learn is basically what it is. So I hope to be back next time. So.
Well, we hope to have you back, and here you go, $125, and congratulations, and we certainly enjoyed having you.
Thank you, Jay.
Well, Jason, well done. You move on to the Final Four, and you bowled tremendously.
Yeah, I threw a lot better ball this time around, and I was on my singles, which was big. I mean, Brian bowled well, and you need to make those marks in order to put pressure on him, and that's what I try to do.
You had, in this match compared to earlier matches, you had, when you had a spare, you had those nine drops on those next balls.
Yeah, and you have to make those, because one string, I mean, the most you can get is 10 of them.
Right.
I mean, you're not going to get 10 of them, but so you got to make the ones you have.
So, tremendous job. You bowled very, very well. It was fun to watch. Both of you bowled very, very well. So, it was a great match. So, that'll do it for this show. We'll be back soon with our next show. I want to thank everybody from Franklin TV, Ryan's Family Amusement, Dave Chesterkove, and I'll thank Richie Myrick again for all their help. So, we will see you next time on New England Candle Picks.
Candle Pins is made possible through the generous support of the U.S. Candle Pin Bowling Association. Learn more at uscandlepin.com. By Ryan Family Amusements in Millis, Massachusetts. Visit ryanfamily.com. By Your Community's Public Access Channel. And by your Franklin friends and neighbors, good folks just like you. Thanks for supporting Franklin TV. And thanks for watching.